Good evening, everyone. Wonderful to be here. I think, you know, we must look forward to having a paratunity, to eating and to speaking in front of audiences. We get to remove these, especially on an evening like this. It's great. So I'm pleased to introduce Elizabeth Rodini tonight. The title of the talk is Journeys and the Afterlife of Things. And I find it a very evocative title, and it brought to mind something we've been talking a lot about, and that's provenance, that art historical term referring to ownership, which is not always the same as possession. And I think Elizabeth's writing deals with the mobility of images and objects and the way they're read. Each is really assigned a value. They're imbued with sets of powers. And their appearance and use reflects this, as well as the shifting fortunes of empire, alliances across cultures, and economic life. Rome is a great city to talk about this kind of stratification and also accretion of objects. It is in some ways like a museum, but to say that it was static would be to miss the life of Rome. And museums, similarly, are thought of as somehow static repositories. And even encyclopedic ones are really in flux. They're shaped by those who own and collect and conserve. And there's always a vantage point embedded, if not explicit. None of these collections are neutral. And we look forward to hearing about the secret and not so silent lives of things. As you know, Elizabeth Rodini has been with the American Academy in Rome now for 3 years. And is now the interim director of the American Academy in Rome. Previously, Elizabeth was at Johns Hopkins University, where she was the founding director of the interdisciplinary program in museums and society in 2006, and has taught in the Department of Art History since 2004. Her scholarship focuses specifically on early modern Venice, and its relationships with the Eastern Mediterranean, including the Islamic world. Her recent book, I think Dario has a copy, and which he is folding up, is about Gentile Bellini's portrait of Sultan Mehmet II. But more than just history of this portrait, it really looks at a variety of historical, art historical matters, from the definition of a portrait to Orientalist practices of collecting to the origins of national patrimony in Italy. Prior to joining Johns Hopkins, Elizabeth was the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation funded curator at the University of Chicago's Smart Museum of Art. I always think that's appropriately named, where she organized exhibitions on topics ranging from antiquity to the mid-20th century. Elizabeth won a Fulbright USIA fellowship to Italy in 1992 to 93, and the Hopkins Excellence in Teaching Award in 2009, and was also a visiting fellow at the Bard Graduate Center in New York in 2018. Elizabeth has a PhD in art history from the University of Chicago, an MA in the history of art at the University of Michigan, and a BA in history and Italian literature. You can see a through line here from University of Wisconsin in Madison. Her writing has appeared in numerous periodicals, and her essays have appeared in edited volumes, including Typical Venice, with a question mark, Venetian Commodities, 13th through 16th centuries, and The Turk and Islam in the Western Eye, 1450 to 1700. The subtitle of the recent book is The Lives and Afterlives of an Iconic Image. And this reflects her ongoing concern with the mobility of people, culture, and ideas transmitted through objects. It's a delight to bring Elizabeth to the podium. Elizabeth Rodini.
Thank you. My eye on time. Thank you, Mark. That's it. I'll do the evening. It's really an honor to be standing here at the podium tonight and speaking to you as an interim director. I send my thanks to Mark and the whole staff for trusting me with this responsibility. And I hope my presentation tonight helps you to get to know me a bit better, that it makes some connections with the work you, and I'm talking to you, the AAR fellows, do across practices and disciplines, and that in this way it can be a vector for some good conversation tonight and moving forward. So, what can we learn from a single painting? Tonight, I'm going to approach that question with a deep, hard look at this portrait, on which I've recently published a book, as you've seen, very long in the works, and so still very much on my mind. It may seem worlds away from Rome and the American Academy, but my aim is to convince you otherwise. For me, this painting is a spur to asking bigger questions, and for connecting art, even old, slightly out-of-fashion pictures like this one, with issues of contemporary relevance. This is how I like to work, from the small to the big, from the anecdote to the larger narrative. So let me introduce you to this picture, and then return to a few more general introductory points before launching into my story. The portrait was produced in 1480 and depicts the Ottoman Sultan Mehmet II. It was painted by Gentile Bellini, a Venetian artist who had been sent to Mehmet's court in Istanbul as part of an official diplomatic exchange. Sultan Mehmet ruled the Ottoman Empire, and he is known in Turkish as Fatih, or conqueror. This is because in 1453, at the ripe old age of 21, he sacked the Byzantine capital of Constantinople and remade it into the seat of his own rapidly expanding empire. And for clarity, I'm going to call his capital Istanbul, though the actual nomenclature is more complicated than the name Constantinople endured for many centuries. In addition to being a great warrior, Mehmet was a vastly knowledgeable and effective patron of both architecture and visual arts. He gathered the very best practitioners to his court from East and West, as far as he could stretch his influence. In 1479, he sent envoys to Venice to ask for the loan of their most skilled portraitists. The Venetians chose Gentile Bellini, older brother to the now more famous Giovanni, and painter to the Doge, or the ruler of Venice. We know very little about Gentile's stay at the Ottoman court, just scraps from stray documents, a few diary reports, and the influential but often suspect writings of Giorgio Vasari, the 16th century biographer. Today, the portrait, which belongs to the National Gallery in London, is extremely damaged. General consensus is that at most, only 10% of the pigment on the canvas was put there by Gentile himself. The remainder is repainting and restoration. This fact has led to significant questions about its attribution. It's been given to and taken away from Gentile many times, dismissed by art historians and discounted by museums. For years, it hung in the basement of the National Gallery among second-rate and problematic works. And this is where I first saw it in 2003. Today, it is generally agreed to be by Gentile and to be the picture he produced in Istanbul. And it is now on long-term loan to the Victoria and Albert Museum across town from the National Gallery. And I'll say more about why in a moment. Now, you may hear and wonder why I have devoted years to a second-rate painting. And I hope my fascination with it will become clear to you over the course of the next 45 minutes or so. The damage to the canvas is not incidental to my interest. I'm convinced that this was once a work of very high quality. After all, it was painted for the Ottoman Sultan by one of the most admired Venetian artists of the day. To me, its story is not that of a second-rate painting that happens to have survived, but of a significant picture transformed by time. I've come to think of missing pigments and aggressive restorations not negatively as loss, but positively as spurs to inquiry. To my mind, its worn surface is an invitation to ask questions about what happened to this painting after it was completed, what made it lose its sheen and surface, where has it hung, who has seen it, and how have they responded? What is its story beyond the rather static moment of its production in 1480? What happens if we put it back in motion? This is the journey of my title. Afterlives refers to how an artwork continues to exist in both fact and recollection, even when the thing itself is gone. So my talk tonight will trace Gentile's picture up to the present, pausing to look more deeply into a few revealing chapters of its history. I'll also consolidate each of these chapters around some more broadly resonant themes or questions. First, I want to take a harder look at its condition and the expectations we bring to historic works of art, in particular paintings, including how we consider their value and how these considerations are impacted by spaces of display, the museums that Mark mentioned a moment ago. Then I'll turn back to the picture's production in 1480, but we'll organize this discussion around questions of likeness and resemblance, thinking about why Sultan Mehmet might have wanted a portrait like this one and gone to so much trouble to get it. From there, we will fast forward to 1865, the date of the painting's rediscovery in the modern era, and I will spend the rest of my talk focusing on themes relevant to its more recent history, including in the context of Orientalism and colonial activity in the 19th century, its place in rising claims to national patrimony in the 20th century, and finally, as a sign of shifting political ideologies in 21st century Turkey. I'm interested in what the painting has come to mean as it moves about in the world, as an artifact, but also as an image and an idea. Now, this may seem like a lot of weight to place on a single picture and a rather particular argument, but I believe that the larger notion of the afterlife of things can engage many of us in the work we do, whether we are historians or photographers, archaeologists or poets, architects, composers, or preservationists. And I see it clearly this year in the theme of reception, collection, and archives that run through so many of your projects. It is a guiding concept to me as well, a filo conductore, a thread across much of what I do. But rather than trying to survey this idea across the scope of my work, which I'm happy to talk to you about in another context, I've decided to take a deep dive into a single image. In the spirit of the AAR shop talks, this approach tells you a lot about how I think, and I hope it can open up a year of conversations for us around how artworks and other objects exist in the world, how they are continually reconfigured, reimagined, and reinvigorated as they travel across time and space. So let's get back to this matter of condition and problematize it a bit more, because condition is critical to how we value historic objects in the present, and those valuations are anything but neutral. For me, as I've already indicated, damage is a reminder of the life of the picture. And if we pay attention to damage as a positive signifier rather than as simply a gap or a loss, some interesting questions arise. First, let's think about that 90% of pigment gone missing from this canvas. Because of it, Gentile's portrait of Mehmet has often been dismissed as not worthy of study. We know that it was worked on extensively in the 19th century by restorers. Their guiding philosophy was basically to make paintings fit their own ideas about what old pictures should look like. This included cropping, repainting, and adding dark varnishes, or what they call patinas, to make them look old. As one contemporary Italian put it, the damned restorers have destroyed more than time itself. Now, in fact, X-rays reveal that what we see on this canvas, if not fully by Gentile's hand, is quite true what he painted in its outline and details. So we can make arguments about the picture's content with considerable confidence. Still, the fact of loss raises some provocative questions. For example, Why are we comfortable studying the fragments of ancient sculpture and architecture, but insist on integrity with historic paintings? Is this because we think of them as images on a surface rather than as artifacts existing in three dimensions? And is this a bias produced by our own modern technologies of projection? How would it change things to rethink paintings as artifacts? Would that help us get a better handle on their histories and complexity? From there, how can we better integrate the history of condition and conservation into our art historical studies? It's an inconvenient truth that old paintings rarely, if ever, come down to us in a pristine state. In fact, the more famous the artwork, the greater the chance that it has undergone multiple restorations. It may not be at all what it seems. This raises all sorts of questions about authenticity and value. For example, at what point can we no longer call the great Raphael a Raphael? A second set of questions that arises from the matter of missing paint concerns the museum. Damage can remind us that Gentile's portrait has not always hung in the safe, protected spaces of the National Gallery, but that it came there from somewhere else. This simple fact also suggests that we think harder about museums as players in the history of objects, not as neutral spaces, but as active ones. And before I move on, I want to point out the giant figure in the foreground by Michael Rockowitz. It references Assyrian sculptures and is related to some figures that are going to appear later in my talk. And I was really hoping Michael would be here tonight for our talk, but unfortunately, he was unable to make it. We're so used to museums that it's easy to forget how strange they really are and how radically they reframe the objects they contain. Accepting a modern theory that museum objects have nothing to do with museums. They come from somewhere else and they were made from some other purpose. Even a classic museum object like an altarpiece or an old master portrait in its origins is alien to the museum environment. But those environments can tell us a lot about how an object has been revalued and reinterpreted over time. For example, when it first arrived in London in 1917, Gentile's picture was hung with other paintings of the Venetian school. This classified it as a notable picture in the history of art. But one thing the archives revealed is that there was a lot of doubt among experts, even early on, about whether it was good enough for these galleries. It seems that the museum caved to public pressure. The portrait of Sultan Mehmet was known, was popular, was interesting, and was positioned thus accordingly. And today's museums, I think, face similar challenges all the time, balancing priorities. After World War II, the painting was demoted by the director, Martin Davies, who said it was very much worn and neglected and almost entirely repainted. He moved it to Gallery A, the basement space for problem pictures, where I first saw it. And here we arrive at the fascinating and very current matter of museum geography. Typically, venerated works go up above, and less valued ones in dark corners or deep basements. This is something many museums are thinking about and reevaluating now, because it has typically meant European works, especially painting, upstairs in the grand galleries, other media, and especially other cultures, namely African, Indigenous American, Asian, and Oceanic, in those lesser forgotten spaces. The geography of the museum sends important messages, forges canons, it's far from neutral. More recently, Gentile's portrait has had a happier history. It's become something of a media star, traveling to exhibitions in New York, Boston, Brussels, Istanbul, and others. And it's now on long-term loan at the Victoria and Albert Museum, where it has a more prominent, but still not grade A, it's right next to an elevator, presence in the galleries. I think its star has risen because it emblemizes a current interest in global art history, as well as in the role of trade in cultural development. Its placement at the V&A is an expression of this moment. It's in a gallery dedicated to mercantile exchange in the early modern Mediterranean, along with metalwork, carpets, books, and so forth. Here, as Alan Crookham has noted, it's not presented as an object of fine art, where its status would be secondary, but as a historical document. Also important is the V&A itself, which was founded in connection with 19th century British desires to create and control world markets, And I could say a lot more about that if you're interested, but we can save it for the Q&A. So there's this wonderful synergy here between the painting's own history and its space of display, a sort of museological resonance, to use the phrase of Stephen Greenblatt. Let's move now to chapter two, which takes us back to the production of the picture and to that cross-cultural encounter that supports the installation of the DNA. In fact, the studies of this painting by art historians have typically centered on two points. First, the extent to which it is a cross-cultural artifact, and second, how it fits into histories of representation of the other. I want to explore these two ideas as they intersect around the question of likeness, also described as verisimilitude, naturalism, and mimesis. At the heart of this investigation is the question of what we expect pictures to do, especially certain kinds of pictures out of certain kinds of traditions, and how we can compare our expectations to those of other times and places. It's a complicated discussion, so let me just try and hit on a few key points with regard to Gentile's picture. Art historians have often called this one of the first, even the first, accurate representation of a Turk in Europe. Its scale, color, and lifelike qualities, including illusionism of space and surfaces, prompt this interpretation, especially when it is compared to other images of the Sultan made in Western metals and prints at this time. So people have argued, for example, that painting shows Mehmet alien and sick, thin and kind of yellow in complexion. And he did in fact die within a year of painting's completion. One problem with this interpretation is that it takes a wholly European point of view. It assumes that the reason lifelikeness matters is because it helps Europeans make sense of a distant group of people, fitting the portrait into later traditions of mapping and imaging that sought to assemble all the world's people in one controlling visual ensemble, for example, at the border of maps or in the pages of costume books, as you see here. But this is not at all why the painting was produced. The patron, Mehmet, had no need to confirm to himself what he looked like. If he didn't have a mirror of the type beginning to emerge in Venice, he certainly had other reflective surfaces of metal or water in which to see his own face. So we need a different way to explain Mehmet's commission of a naturalistic portrait. One thing we know about Mehmet is that he was a hugely inquisitive, eclectic thinker and collector. He read classical history with tutors in Arabic, Greek, and Latin. He owned objects ranging from Christian relics to crystal lenses, and he patronized a range of artists at court, including many that he recruited to come to Istanbul from Italy. This portrait is by a local artist, but clearly inspired in its rendering of the head and body by Italian forms. He was also fascinated by new technology in architecture, ornaments, and the visual arts. He even had a small collection of printed engravings, which was a radically new way of making a single image in multiple. But the most important artistic innovations coming out of Italy at this time were representational. They had to do with a rising interest in naturalistic imagery, things like the study of anatomy, techniques of single-point perspective, and other tools that supported the idea of a picture as a window through which we see the world as it is. And I put that in quotes. So a move from pictures that look like the one on the left to ones that look like that on the right. These examples are by the same artist at the same date. So this is not about a linear shift or about progress. By the 1480s, the greatest praise one could have of an Italian portrait was that it was practically alive, that all it left was speech. Now, Mehmet was a savvy student of artistic developments in Italy. He was well aware of these representational trends, and he appears to have been keenly interested in naturalism. This sheet of portrait heads is attributed to the young Mehmet, suggesting that he was maybe not a terrific artist, maybe with some training, but that he did seem to have an inclination early on to the peculiarities of natural forms. Several stories tied to Gentile's stay at Mehmet's court also echo this theme. The most dramatic, but also highly suspect, is that he had an enslaved man executed in order to assess the accuracy of a painting of the beheaded St. John the Baptist. This story was often repeated here in 1832 about European fears of the Ottomans than about Mehmet himself. Still, at its core lies this idea that Mehmet had an interest in the ability of pictures to duplicate the visual world. What I want to suggest is that when we look at this picture and think of it as in some ways true to nature, we should rethink why it looks that way. To my mind, it's not because the Venetians wanted to see what a Turk looked like. And by the way, Mehmet absolutely rejected the idea that he was some sort of typical Turk. He was atypical, if anything. I think we're better off considering this picture as a sort of test that Mehmet set to James Hewley to show him what the emerging mode of Italian painting could actually do. There's one quick coda to this idea that perhaps we can discuss more later. And that is to say that, yes, this is the story of a Muslim ruler commissioning a figurative image. Many people are surprised by this, but such imagery is not banned in Islam, and it was certainly not banned from an all-powerful sultan who could really do whatever he liked. In fact, this is another relevant framework for thinking about the variable status and potential of lifelike imagery. It may also play into what happened next in the life of Gentile's portrait. In brief, it disappeared for 400 years, and that created a lot of trouble for me in my book. But it seems to have left Istanbul shortly after it was painted in 1480, and it may have been discarded by Mehmet's son, Bayezid II, who was quite devout and disapproved of representational imagery. Rumors of its whereabouts enhanced its mystery and its reputation. It was never forgotten. I like to think it was rolled up and carted away in the pouch of some savvy Venetian merchant. But this history is hazy at best, and I'm going to skip over here and take us rapidly, time traveling, to 1865. This is the year the painting enters the modern record. Its reemergence is scenographic. It's a misty October evening in Venice. An elegant British gentleman is climbing carefully into his sleek black gondola. He's startled by a shabby figure stepping out of the shadows. The man has something for sale. A painting, he says, by the great Gentile Bellini, his infamous portrait of Mehmet II, on special offer at only £12 sterling. The gentleman, a dedicated collector of pictures, snaps it up. Sure, he has found a lost masterpiece of Venetian art. This gentleman was often Henry Layard, and with his purchase, Gentile's portrait enters a new chapter in its history, binding it to some of the key cultural tendencies of 19th century Europe, including imperialism, colonialism, and the related act, important for museums, of accumulating cultural riches from across the globe and displaying them to a curious audience back home. Orientalism, with a capital O, is the term coined by Edward Said in 1978 to describe this relationship. Said argued that the lands and peoples of the Orient, what we would today call the Middle East, were understood by Europeans, above all, as spoils to their own culture. The Orient was freely available for exploration and explanation, not to mention exploitation. But, Said argued, the resulting understandings were less about that other than they were about the self. What I want to propose here is that Layard's experiences as a scion of the British Empire orientalized Gentile's portrait of Mehmet, that he made it over as an imaginary reflection of himself and his experiences. It's a proposal we can trace in a few different contexts. Let's start with archaeology. As a young man, Layard was one of those gentleman adventurer explorers who preceded the formalization of archaeology as a science. In the 1840s, he traveled to Nineveh in modern-day Iraq, where he excavated Assyrian artifacts and shipped them by the freight load to the British Museum. Here we see Layard lording over the extraction of a great winged bull, and this picture gives a sense of the imperial might that was required for these expeditions. There's a lot of reading of the image we could do here that's really interesting. Here's how the sculptures look today. Imposing but clearly displaced, obviously bolted to the museum walls, and they're mismatched. If you look closely at their feet, you'll see one is a bull and one is a lion. Hooves and claws. But they declare their architectural grandeur, but they do so with unmistakable reminders that they are spoliated fragment. Remember, these are the same creatures Michael Rockowitz paid homage to in fourth project in Trafalgar Square, pointing us to a contemporary conversation about the paradoxical role museums play, both in spoliation and in protection of objects. Because as you may recall, similar objects were destroyed by ISIS in Iraq in 2015. Another picture from Layard's memoirs is also telling. It shows two modern Arabs, assistants on a dig, astounded to the point of caricature, to meet their ancestor carved of stone. Gestures. For Layard, this face-to-face is a sign of time standing still. He saw the modern Arabs as residual, or as he put it, as much the remains of Nineveh and Assyria as are the rude heaps of stone and ruined palaces of the region. A second frame for Layard's engagement in the so-called Orient was diplomatic. In 1877, 12 years after purchasing Gentile Bellini's portrait of Mehmet, Layard was appointed British ambassador to the Ottoman court. Like Gentile, he traveled as a government envoy to Istanbul. This coincidence must have seemed particularly striking when Ambassador Layard found himself meeting with the reigning Sultan, Abdulhamid II, in some of the very same spaces frequented by Gentile Bellini during his own stay at the Ottoman court. In 1880, exactly 400 years after Gentile completed his portrait of Mehmet, Layard retired from the ambassadorial service, moved to Venice, settled into a palace on the Grand Canal, recalled his painting collection from England, and hung Gentile's portrait prominently on a palace wall. Did Layard recognize these parallel experiences? He never actually tells us. But in 1912, a journalist put precisely such words in his mouth. Although Layard only held the appointment to the Ottoman embassy for a short time, he often recalled it with interest when contemplating the portrait of the Sultan Mehmet II by Gentile Bellini. These connections may be coincidental, but they are also evocative, and they make me wonder what Layard thought about when he gazed on the portrait of Mehmet. How did his experiences reframe and reconstitute that historic portrait? Next, we have the matter of Layard as collector. His relationship with Gentile's picture was highly personal, distinct from anything we might find in a modern museum. Guests to his Venetian palace described how it hung among other exotic imports, including marbles he had excavated at Nineveh and a collection of, quote, Hindu and Persian arms. It was part of the spectacle at the Layard's renowned house parties. One visitor recalled seeing it through the glimmer of torchlight, the sparkle of gems, the flash of gold and silverware, among the hazy, darting figures of women on unforgettable evenings among Venetian society. Years later, another guest described school holidays spent with the Layards and having to shoo the family parrot away from their pictures. We could simply write all of this off as the eccentricities of a private collection displayed in a personal space. Orientalist theory, however, read such repurposing as an act of domestication, one that reduces the surviving traces of a lost society to a decorative gesture. Take as a comparison this collection of ancient Assyrian cylinder seals, transformed by Layard into a set of jewelry for his wife, Lady Enid. And she's wearing it here. And listen now to a passage from his 1849 memoirs, The Remains of Nineveh, describing the wife of an Arab sheikh. She has undoubtedly claims to more than ordinary beauty, he wrote. Hanging from each ear and reaching to her waist was an enormous earring of gold, terminating in a tablet of the same material, carved and ornamented with four turquoises. Her nose was also adorned with a prodigious gold ring set with jewels of such ample dimensions that it covered the mouth and was to be removed when the lady ate. Ponderous rows of strong beads, Assyrian cylinders, fragments of coral, agates, and parti-colored stones hung from her wrists and ankles, making a loud jingling sound as she walks. To the Arabs, Layard concludes, she was perfection. Now, Lady Enid, not incidentally, apparently hated wearing her husband's exoticizing confections, and we can see these as another colonial imposition here on the body of his wife. In the schema of Edward Said, Orientalism and feminization go hand in hand. What I'm proposing is an Orientalist frame for Gentile's picture, built out of several distinct experiences. Layard's work as an excavator and appropriator of Assyrian materials, his time spent at the Ottoman court as a diplomatic envoy face-to-face with the Sultan, and his possession of a Venetian palace ornamented with exotic fragments. We can add this portrait to that collective. It shows Layard dressed in the garb of the Bakhtiari people, a costume he put on, he says, as a disguise for safe passage during his archaeological expeditions to Nineveh. This image returns me to Edward Said, and I imagine Layard's relationship with Gentile's portrait in an Orientalist light, an image of the self understood via a portrait of the other. Of course, Gentile's immediate subject is a 15th century Sultan, and he was a Renaissance painter. But the complexity of experiences the portrait embodies are strikingly like those of Austin Henry Layard. And I wonder, how could this 19th century British archaeologist and collector, this Orientalist servant of empire, not have colonized Gentile's portrait as well, making it over as akin to his own personal history? Through this lens, just as Said predicted, Gentile Bellini's portrait of Mehmet II reflects back the image of Austin Henry Layard himself. So let's move now from the 19th century into the 20th and to another stop on this portrait circuitous journey to the present. We are still in Venice, but now it is 1915. Lord and Lady Layard are deceased, and the National Gallery is trying to extract their pictures from Italy before the rising forces of war make this impossible. But I want to focus on a different challenge to extraction, namely Italian resistance to letting this picture go. Around the portrait of Mehmet, in fact, we find an early claim to national patrimony that points ahead to many of the debates preoccupying museums today, including many here in Italy. National patrimony is the idea that a people, or more specifically, a nation as a political entity, has an inherent claim to the ownership of cultural goods. The most famous case is the Elgin or Parthenon marbles, which were removed by Lord Elgin from the Parthenon temple in Athens in the early 19th century and have been housed for over 200 years at the British Museum. Greece wants them back, and the conflict is not new. It dates back at least to Lord Byron's poetic laments of 1812 over their removal and defacement. A century later, the British ambassador in Italy pointed to Greece as a warning to the National Gallery as it sought to remove Gentile's portrait from Venice. The Mehmet picture is regarded by the Italians somewhat as the Athenians regarded the Elgin marbles, he cautioned. It's a fortuitous comparison, helping us make larger sense of the struggle over this picture by pointing in two directions, one historical and one more ethical or conceptual. The history is pretty straightforward. Italy, like other European states of the 19th century, saw material heritage as a way of solidifying a sense of shared cultural and thus political identity. It followed the lead of France, which had developed the notion of patrimoine as an instrument of nation building during the revolution. So the Italians began to write protectionist laws aimed at keeping the material culture of Italy in Italy. In some ways, this was a positive act of self-determination. Italy, established in 1870, was a new state. It was relatively poor in monetary resources, but rich in artistic ones. And so it made sense to consolidate a notion of identity around them. But there was also a defensive aspect to this conflict. As the Italians watched foreigners, in particular wealthy Brits and Americans, carrying off their national treasures. The Italian writer Alessandro Manzoni foresaw this problem and lamented in a letter, "What can I say of London? The English have no taste, for in general they are anything but good artists, but in collecting objects of art and science they are second to none and seem to know no limits in spending when it comes to acquisitions that will make their museums more interesting and complete." To stop what many saw as a cultural hemorrhaging, Italian politicians began lobbying for legal control over artistic exports and writing related legislation. One of the first Such laws, number 185, passed in 1902, took the form of a list of, quote, objects of great merit for history or art in private hands. It declared that these were to remain in Italy, ideally to be acquired by the state for the public good. Among the works on the first protected list was Gentile Bellini's portrait of Mehmet II, I highlighted for you here, which the writer Angelo Ponti described just a few years later as a work of Italian genius. But what does it mean to call this painting Italian? There was some logic to the term in 1912, but retrospectively, historically, it's not so simple a definition. Venice was an independent republic in 1480 and had already been so for six centuries. It survived until 1789 when it finally collapsed to Napoleonic pressure. By contrast, in 1902, Italy was barely three decades old. More importantly, Gentile's picture had been commissioned and paid for not by an Italian or even a Venetian, but by an Ottoman and an Istanbul. The Turks may have had a better claim to the portrait than anyone else. And in fact, from the outset of this debate, the British press treated Gentile's portrait as an object of international interest, tying it directly to modern geopolitics. Day after Lady Layard's death in 1912, the Leicester Chronicle declared the painting to have a, quote, topical interest, and linked Mehmet II to his distant successor, the beleaguered Sultan Mehmet V, who was fighting for the survival of the Ottoman Empire in the Balkans. These struggles soon erupted into the First World War. When the British public thought about sultans, Ottomans, and empire, they didn't need to check history books for points of reference. And for anyone unable to link current events to historical ones or war to painting, the Pall Mall Gazette spelled it out nicely. Even the Philistine in Affairs of Art will note the irony of chance that brings us the portrait of the victor of Constantinople at a moment when that peerless city, the gate of East and West, is trembling in the balance. It is one of those flashes of coincidence that lend history past its magic. Paradoxically, it was internationalism, as well as a legal technicality, that finally allowed the British to take possession of Gentile's picture. The protectionist laws Italy had put in place were directed at Italian material, and so they did not apply to works of art that had been imported. But, read the fine print, Layard had exhibited his collection in England before moving it back to reside with him in Venice. So officially, Layard's paintings were imports and could not be retained under Italian law number 185. Thus, in 1915, under strenuous circumstances and threats of bombardments on land and sea, the British government arranged for crate loads of Layard's art to travel across Europe and over the English Channel. The crates arrived safely at the National Gallery, one by one, during the spring of 1916. As I studied this history, I've been quite frankly amazed at the attention the British gave to these pictures in the face of much graver dangers, even existential dangers on the continent. And it is a fact that's made me think hard about art as a refuge in times of crisis. And so we move ahead another century to 1999, when Gentile Bellini's portrait of Mehmet II was sent back to Istanbul for the first time to star in a one-man or one-painting show. It was a smash hit with over 30,000 visitors coming to see it in the span of just 1 month. Newspaper coverage was prolific and the headlines grand. Second Conquest, Welcome Home Conqueror, or Fatih. We're here. Fatih's famous portrait brought to Istanbul, and we see the courier from the National Gallery helping escort it off the airplane to a reception worthy of, well, a sultan, perhaps. Visitors were equally enthusiastic. One of them told an American reporter, "We have seen this picture so many times in so many school books and on so many walls over so many years that it's really imprinted on our brains. Now it's finally here, the real thing." Exhibition organizers, journalists, writers, and other cultural observers agree. Gentile's image is ever present in the consciousness of modern Turks. So, forgive the picture, I went to Istanbul in the fall of 2018 to track down what I could find of this picture, including both the history of its exhibition in 1999 and its resonance in popular memory. The final portion of my talk will focus on what I found there and what I learned about the power of this picture in Turkey today. I discovered a changing fate, that over the course of just 20 years, its status has evolved significantly, reflecting rapid changes in Turkish politics, both domestic and international. My research was conducted through books and online, but also through conversations on the streets and in the marketplaces of Istanbul with the help of some really wonderful Turkish friends and partners. The exhibition of 1999 and the circumstances surrounding it tell us a lot about where Turkey was at the end of the 20th century. The intention of the curators at the Yapı Kredi Cultural Institution was to present a history of cross-cultural exchange, of harmony and balance in the late 15th century. Gentile's picture stood at the center, flanked by photo murals that told on the one side the story of the Venetian artist and on the other that of his Ottoman patron. So the portrait was the only original work of art on view and stood for the flowering of a mutually profitable encounter between two distinguished cultural traditions. This perspective made a lot of sense at the time because Turkey was pressing its case to join the European Union as part of a world order characterized by unity and a shared, or at least a mutually respectful vision. 20 plus years later, that vision is seriously fractured as President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, here in a gigantic political poster, and yes, I think there are interesting connections with portrait that are fun to consider. As he steps back from Europe and toward a more inward nationalist vision for Turkey and its future, in lockstep with so much of the contemporary world. In Erdogan's Turkey, Ottoman heritage is less a point of connection than one of distinction, a way to perhaps coin a phrase of making Turkey great again. He and his conservative AKP party have begun to reclaim some of the signs of Ottomanism that were discarded in the 1920s when Turkey, under its founding president, Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, sought to align itself with what were seen as more modern values. For example, discarding the Ottoman alphabet, banning the Fez, and moving the capital away from Istanbul to Ankara. Erdogan, by contrast, has embraced many Ottoman symbols. And under him, a cultural neo-Ottomanism has flourished. It's evident in architecture, fashion, advertising, television, film, and many spheres of daily life. Most relevant to our topic is the new attention he has brought to Mehmet II, not only as Sultan, but as conqueror or Fatih. May 29th, Conquest Day, is now a grand celebration in Istanbul, complete with speeches, parades, and displays of military power. I want to read Gentile's portrait across these two moments, 1999 and today, as a cipher of geopolitics. Its renown and its reputation support this interpretation. According to Orhan Pamuk, the great Turkish writer, Gentile's portrait has spawned so many copies, variations, and adaptations that there cannot be a literate Turk who has not seen it hundreds, if not thousands, of times. My own internet research confirmed this statement. Fatih Mehmet is everywhere online, and Gentile's portrait is his default image. I found it on the cover of countless publications, including works of history and fiction for all ages, on historic stamps and coins, and on all sorts of merchandise. Here is a small, poorly photographed collection of some of that stuff, and I also have one visual aid. A tote bag that I purchased and carried around Istanbul, and I got some really great conversation out of it. So, well worth the investment. The most surprising item I found was Fatih Sultan Mehmet perfume, a quote, sumptuous, where is it up here? A quote, sumptuous smorgasbord of scent, harking back to the exotica of grand bygone times, at about 200 euros for 50 milliliters. The handsome dark bottle bears a label impressed with Gentile's portrait of Mehmet. The portrait also lives on quite powerfully in the world of internet memes. And by the way, when I learned that the Italian pronunciation of meme was meme, I thought that would be a good book title. Fortunately, wiser heads prevailed. Although easily dismissed as trivia, meme, these virtual flashes of pop cultural reinterpretation help us understand what the picture means, not only in the official political messaging or in the commodity marketplace, but in the larger ecosystem of ideas fostered by individuals and their social circles. Some of these memes are funny, but on the outrageous Ottoman memes website, yes, there is such a thing, we see Gentile's Mehmet triumphing over Russians, Greeks, Serbs, and the European Union. In the vertiginous world of the internet, he is a wise and observant Muslim ruler, but also a rapper, a video game avatar, and a supervillain. His portrait heads Wikipedia's entry on Mehmet II, as well as a 15 Mehmet Facebook page that is freewheeling and little patrolled, a site for all sorts of nationalist and Islamist-tinged postings. This sort of ripping on history is particularly charged on the internet, but in the broadest sense, it is not exceptional or new. Nostalgia for lost moments and an illustrious past has roots as deep as written history, and revivalist heritage is a growing industry. When it's hitched to political discontent infused with nationalism, however, it's a sentiment that can head rapidly toward danger, excluding and often targeting those perceived as outsiders. In today's Turkey, Mehmet II, as represented by Gentile, is one of the most recognizable emblems of neo-Ottomanist longing. In my research online and in the streets of Istanbul, I was able to confirm Pamuk's claim that nearly every Turk knows Gentile's painting. Of nearly 130 people I surveyed, 95% recognized the picture, and 75% clearly named the subject as Fatih Mehmet. Many of the others identified him more generally as rescuer, liberator, or savior of Istanbul. What interested me the most was the way their responses to the picture split along political lines. I'm generalizing here, but let me give you a few examples. I interviewed a 40-year-old man named Steen, who described himself as a classic Muslim and a conservative. I love this guy, Tistine told me as he looked at the image on my footbed. Fatih is the center of everything. He even distilled Turkish history and its contemporary circumstances down to a debate around this figure. Those who do not like Fatih, he said, do not like us, by which he meant Turks loyal to the nationalist vision of President Erdogan. The people on the left, he said, blame everything on Fatih. And in fact, those opposed to Erdogan and his conservative politics told me much the same thing. One wrote, I used to feel positive things looking at this portrait. Now it's repulsive because of government policies. Another associated it with arrogance, unsupportable self-grandeur, and the dark days of neo-Ottomanism. For Özge Samanci, who wrote a graphic style memoir about growing up in Turkey in the 1980s, the portrait recalls a very annoying poster on a high school bulletin board. Their image to this portrait was captioned, you were at the age when Fatih conquered Istanbul. For her, this was a suffocating, judgmental message that summarizes her adolescence in Turkey and that she associates directly with this painting. I'm going to add a quick coda to this chapter of my narrative because there was another modern resurgence of Fatih Mehmet's image more recently, just a month or so before my book appeared in print. In June of 2020, the municipality of Istanbul spent nearly $1 million to purchase this double portrait at auction, a huge amount of money for a city that was in deep economic crisis, and on a portrait of undetermined origin and authorship. Whether it is workshop of Gentile Bellini, as Sotheby's claimed, is a matter of faith. The purchase affirms again the power of Gentile's image in modern Turkey, but it also complicated my political interpretation of its legacy, because the mayor behind the purchase, Ekrem İmamoğlu, is a member of the left-leaning party that opposes President Erdogan and his ultra-nationalist neo-Ottomanist agenda. One journalist tweeted that the purchase was a rare unifying event in Turkey. And yet, this cartoon, showing Istanbul overwhelmed by recent floods as İmamoğlu holds aloft his precious purchase, makes it clear that debate continues. So, it's fair to say that I found Fatih Sultan Mehmet everywhere in Istanbul and nowhere. So too is Gentile's portrait widely known, but generally so. It resides deep in the national consciousness, even if its history cannot always be named or explained. When I look at it, all of the stories I have told you converge. At the same time, it reflects back on my thinking about topics that may seem to have little to do with a strange, somewhat bedraggled Renaissance portrait. Topics like 19th century imperialism, claims to cultural patrimony, and the press of nationalist rhetoric in our own time. This is what I mean by the afterlife of things, histories of an object that are not necessarily material, not necessarily attached directly to that object, but that weigh powerfully on how we understand it.
I think I get to moderate my own questions.
Yes.
So.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi, thank you so much. Do we know much about all that destruction in the picture that you showed where the 90% of the paint is gone? Exactly what happened?
No, we have no idea. That's sort of, Can we guess? Well, I have a chapter in which I'm trying to guess where it was for 400 years, and I follow three threads of that. And I think it most likely hung in a Venetian palace, but it's hard to know for sure. There's debates about whether it was painted on canvas or panel originally. It's on canvas now, but sometimes panel paintings have been removed to canvas. I mean, what I like to imagine, as I sort of indicated, is that it was on canvas. And actually, I spoke with a fellow last year, a fellow in conservation, Gene Domino, who had some really interesting things to say about why it seems more likely that it was probably painted on canvas than panel. And so if it's on canvas, it can be rolled up, it can be stored. So I imagine that it had a lot of damage in the journey. But to me, I sort of see this absence as a sign of its desirability, right? The painting that's just sort of kept on the wall and nobody moves and leaves in the attic, you may have all the original surface. But the fact that it's so damaged, to me, I take that as a sign of its that people wanted it and then it moved around. So we don't know. We have some records about the conservation that took place. It was one of the first things that Leonard did, because he took it to a conservator, and his letters are really interesting, because his first letter says he's writing to, his name will come to me, he's writing to one of his fellow collectors, and he says, I found it, it's the most beautiful, I found the missing painting, and it's beautiful, and over the course of just about a month in the letters, he seems to say, well, maybe it needs a little work, and maybe it's not in such great shape. So he kind of talked it up at the beginning and then realized that it was damaged and it needed a lot of work. But since the early 20th century, there's not been much done on it because it is very fragile, and so conservators are hesitant to mess with what's in there.
Same direction. Do you, since Laird was involved in that also, probably, do you propose to connect what you call his orientalizing the picture in a more, I suppose, or in a ideological sense, but with physical interventions that he may have directed or required by restorers? So that's one question. And the other is in the X-ray or infrared that you showed us, the rather striking, very rich fabric with pearls and gems, etc., which is in the foreground, look very different. So, do you have more to say about the state of conservation of that part, and maybe on the its role also in the iconography and in its afterlife of the painting?
Right. Okay. So, to the first question, I don't know that. Is this the picture you're referring to? Maybe.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't really know much about it. I don't think, to my knowledge, there's any evidence that they are just directly involved with what the intervention that was on the painting. We know the restorer that he, and restorer is the right word for the 19th century, the restorer that he hired, a guy named Kinsey, who worked a great deal for the National Gallery. But there's no evidence that he was directing the work that happened. Whether Pinti himself is looking at sort of Orientalist paintings of the day and painting off of that kind of 19th century vision of these materials, I think that's an interesting question, right? That is he responding to other sorts of works that he saw? I'm sorry, so that then it looks very different.
Do I have an image where we compare these? Yeah, it's hard to see.
I think there was another image, maybe of a painting of it. Of the portrait?
It's hard to see a detail of
the textile and a detail of the x-ray. But yeah, I think your point is that these look more, I think it's a little hard to see. For example, here, you sort of see this sort of floral pattern, but it's kind of hidden because this is embroidered and this is gems. But the shape is more or less the same.
So,
yeah, no, what I mean is that it looks very different from the upper part. It is.
I see what you mean.
One wonders whether it's in a much better condition.
I see what you're saying.
Or not.
Yeah, it's a good question. Someone posited, you know, that there was some sort of excising of the face at some point that it had, or, you know, another possibility is that it's just been more worked and overworked and overworked. And that sort of falls in line with what I was saying about the more important or alluring a work is, the more attention it gets. So there, in some ways, it wouldn't surprise me if the face has been more manhandled over the course of many centuries than the material itself. So
but that would make the fabric even more interesting. So
yeah.
I was wondering if you had looked at
it. I had not, no. You know, it's funny. I don't know if I can illustrate this because this is being recorded, but I did have a conversation with a conservator, and it's not a lot of information on what we actually know about this painting, and there seems to be a little bit of, it's been complicated for the National Gallery, because it is a very important painting, but it seems to have a lot of problems. So transparency around conservation and condition, I think, is something, it's a larger conversation.
Okay.
So I actually don't know a whole lot more than what's been published, and I did have some conversations with conservators, but they're fairly terse. You know, basically nothing's been done to it since 19.
So in comparison with the other images that you showed us from a similar period, it strikes me that this one has been divorced from landscape, that there's that darkness in the background.
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about the representations of the sort of representations of the Middle East, I'm wondering if there is some kind of story that's in that absence, the sort of void behind him, why there's no landscape there.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I mean, it's a very odd picture. There are many pictures where you have a figure sitting behind the ledge and and there's a squat on there. But to have no background and to have this sort of free floating arch is odd. And there some of the oddness may have to do with the state of conservation. But I guess one answer I might offer to you is that there's a whole very important practice within the Ottoman court of the visibility and the invisibility of the Sultan. And that the visibility of the Sultan through the window played a really important role. The Sultan would sometimes watch without being seen behind the grid, sometimes sort of be partially seen, but the appearance of that figure was rare. And at Topkapi, which Mehmet built, there were series of courts. And in the outer court, essentially anyone could come who wanted to petition the Sultan. And then within the second court, you had sort of members, larger members of the court community. And then there was the innermost court. So there is this whole language in the processional and the ceremonials of the Ottoman Sultans that were really, we know more about them from later centuries, but they were very much, we believe, codified under Mehmet, that made visibility a real privilege. So there is this really interesting question about what it means to make him so visible, right? Because it actually doesn't fit with the iconography of the time in any way. And to put him behind an arch like that sets him up in this architectural space that actually makes very little sense within an Ottoman context. So I don't know that that's really an answer to your question, but it's something that's made me wonder, you know, what is that relationship to the space that was actually occupied by the Sultan? And at Bellini, we have reason to believe he got quite, you know, into the inner sanctum of the Sultan. So maybe he's really thinking about that language of presentation and obfuscation that the arch suggests.
Thank you so much for this talk. It's been great to see more into your, I've learned little bits about what fascinates you, but this seems like the real mothership of your ideas. So this may be an unfair question, but one thing I think that Rome and the experience of the Academy can do for people who are at this stage of a project where you've just closed it, it's clearly still something that really lights you up inside, and that's terrific. But I wonder what piece of it do you feel inside is the hook that's pulling you into something, to the next terrain? Is it looking for another kind of iconic image like this, where it has, I mean, this seems, not every painting can reveal so much about culture and geopolitics over the centuries, you know, it's not unique, but there are not so many examples. Or is it its existence as an object? I know the exhibition that you and I have begun to work on, I see threads of what you're discussing in that. So I wondered what's rising to the surface.
Yeah, such a good question. Such a generous question. Asking me to imagine that I might still do some research. Okay. Remember when I interviewed for the job here, Mark, you said something about the detective. You know, you're not going to get a lot of work done. And I said, yeah, I'll just fill up the vessel for the next going. So there are two things that very much interest me. I'm really interested in the politics of archaeology and heritage. So one idea is to pursue that avenue in a direction yet to be identified. And I'm looking for where that might go. It was really a revelation to me. And I know there are many people that study this, but to me, this sort of politics around this science, right? And how it came to be and how it translates into present conflicts over where objects end up. I think it's fascinating. And I think it's underappreciated. So I'm really interested in politics and heritage. And I'm also sort of seeking, and I may have found it, I'm not going to say exactly where, but this is a project of one thing going across space over time. And Rome is, of course, the paradigm of the place that it is in place, but we go down in time. So I have in mind maybe a project that would take one site and dig through many stories in that site that are not usually in conjunction with each other. So we're familiar with Sant'Amante, where we have the layers of the church, for example. But there are lots where there's a contemporary history that wants to be told, I think, against an ancient history with a different kind of medieval history. So I could imagine doing a project that is maybe a transect of the city that tries to explore it. And even taking inspiration from the fellows to think, are there other ways of writing this? So my book is an academic book that I tried to write in an accessible voice, but I could imagine trying to experiment with different kinds of writing as well, or photography, or maybe a collaborative project that tries to slice the city that way. So that's another way I'm thinking about it. But thank you for asking. Yes.
You may have partially answered this question just now, but I was wondering, could you talk a little bit more about what drew you initially to this particular obscure painting off on the corner of the basement? And at the time, did you have any notion that it was such an image that had such recognition and importance to people in Turkey?
No, I had no idea.
That's amazing.
It was took about, and it was lucky. half of it's luck, right? And persistence. I mean, it took, I wrote a dissertation on the relationship between Venice and the Eastern Mediterranean Islamic world. And it was constructed around three kind of modes, three paradigms, architectural bricolage, maps, and portraiture. And this was maybe, you know, a page of the section of portraiture. And it was after the dissertation, I don't remember, maybe I started to write an article about it, about essentially chapter two here. And I was reading about it, and I read about that 1990. Well, two things hit me. I found out about the 1999 exhibition, and I went, wow. And then I also read, and this is a chapter I had to skip, but I read about 100 years after it was painted, I learned that envoys for the Sultan Murad III, I believe it was, were looking for authentic portraits of the Ottoman sultans in order to make a sort of genealogy. And they sent envoys to Venice to look for authentic portraits. And that piqued so much in my mind. So what is the memory of this painting? Are they responding to a memory of this painting 100 years later? Why Venice? What were they thinking about when they thought about, you know, I'm mistranslating the terms now that are out of, you know, Ottoman Turkish into Italian into English, but still something about the authentic natural, the true image. And so that fascinated me too. Wow, 100 years later, when Ottomans needed a portrait of their sultan, they went to Venice. And you know, the Venetians said, you know, we don't have any such paintings, and they had Veronese disciples, they don't need to paint a bunch of them, and he sent them back. So there was this, so those were two things, and I went, wow, there's more story here. And then I just started looking, you know, and it was sort of detective.
I am not a scholar, I'm a civilian, but I came because my son, who lives here in Rome, just married a girl from Turkey. And it never occurred to me to show her this picture because based on the description, I thought of this as obscure, relatively obscure picture. So I must go home tonight now and see what Senna says about this.
My husband's sister is married to a Turk. She said, no, no one knows that picture. And so, you know.
And did he?
She missed it. I don't know.
Are you an ask him?
I did ask him. I didn't go where I wanted to.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Oh, there's a question, Anna. Sorry.
A question on Zoom.
Yes.
Say a bit more about the process of authenticating this as a Bellini, since 90% of the painting is not original, and that it was missing for 100 years.
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of, I can. I mean, I have to rely on conservators who really, it's really a conservation question, probably, and connoisseurs. I think, we know this is the picture that reappeared. That's not the question. The question is this a picture that Bellini painted? And the pendulum swings back and forth. So I can't really. What I can say is that this is a question that really concerned me when I set out to do a whole project. I thought if I write a traditional art history, then just one person has to sort of come along and say, this isn't the painting you think it is, and the whole thing collapse. So then I started to think, well, is that true? Because there's this idea of the picture that's important. And so I tried to get away from, and I hope that even if someone next year said this isn't the picture, we still have this whole history of what that picture has meant in the present. And we know a lot about, right, what was thought before that. So that's hedging a little bit. That the concern with that question is really what prompted me to think, really to think about these issues of authenticity. Well, what does it mean if we don't know what it is? And to me, it means we have this idea of this thing that's been very powerful, and that we continue to tell stories about. Are there any other Zoom questions? Oh yeah, Grace and then MJ. I don't know how much more time we have.
Okay, well, you can quickly go over this then or skip it if you want, but you mentioned that you had more to say about the Victoria and Albert, and I was hoping we could circle back to that.
Let's see if I can find the slide. Well, it's in the Victoria and Albert, which is essentially a museum of decorative arts. And what's interesting about the Victoria and Albert is it was basically founded on the heels of the 1851 World's Fair. In London, the Crystal Palace exposition, and a lot of the objects in it come from that fair. So in a way, it's kind of a musealization, if that's a word, of this effort to expand British power in the global world of trade and economies. So it was structured to essentially instruct craftspeople in various materials. So actually things were arranged by material. It still is today if you go. It's silver and it's ceramic and it's wood. So it was really arranged to help craftspeople by looking at fine and maybe not so fine examples, you know, refine their skills. So to me that's a fascinating kind of situation to now find this painting that I think is really a product of that trade. Being put on view. So there's a nice kind of resonance between the history of the museum, what it was built to do, and the legacy of Mehmet as someone who was really fostering exchange centuries before. That's the short answer. But that museum was not intended as a museum of fine art to go admire beautiful things. It was really sort of to teach people about these materials in the context of global trade. One more,
Eugenia. Very quickly, thank you. It was fantastic. I think there's a fascinating intersection of fields here. I mean, of course, thinking from the standpoint of someone who works mainly with texts and, you know, interested in philology and reception, both philology and reception came to my mind listening to you. You know, the idea that the classical philology sort of taught us to think in terms of the archetype and a series of witnesses. In this case, we have a traveling archetype, which we have, it's here, it's a single object, and all these errors, which in this case are lacunae of material standing, are within the object, right? So, I mean, I thought there's a very interesting comparison to make, which has potential sort of bearings in terms of thinking across disciplines. And I was actually thinking to what extent, and this is the question, these kind of questions led your work, or have you ever sort of thought in a systematic way about these possibilities, or is this something which just sort of, you know, came up and maybe would be worth pursuing? I'd love to hear your thoughts about it.
Yeah, no, I don't think I've really thought about it that way, but you do make me think that there is a whole tradition, maybe an exaggerated word, that there are examples of copies of this painting and made after it that do fall into that something analogous to a text that's copied and miscopied and this. So there's, for example, I don't have an image of it here, but there is a painting that is essentially an exact copy of it by an early 20th century Venetian painter named Fausto Zanaro. It hangs in a museum in Istanbul. And it looks identical, but it's slightly smaller and the color scheme is slightly off, and it has that kind of neoclassical 19th century, you know, too perfectness to it. And so where this painting has, I don't know, the colors are just slightly off. Zonaro was from right outside Venice. We know he saw this picture, but I think he was painting it from a photograph. And so it scales off the colors a little off. And then there's photography. Layard was really important in using photography to start to document his collection. And he had photos taken and sent them to people, and then people made copies of it. There's also wood engravings of it that sort of stand for it in interesting ways. So I think that may be a way of thinking about it. How did it get actually reproduced? And then what are the kind of errors that came around in the reproduction? And then when you go around Istanbul, you'll see, for example, at Hagia Sophia, there's a big wall panel in Sophia. Was, I don't know now, with the new Hagia Sophia's mosque, but there was a big interpretive wall panel that had a painting of Mehmet, and it was the Zonaro copy of this. Wasn't this. So, you know, there's slippage. And even, sorry, I think I would go to the whole slide deck. Even that newspaper article I showed you, I'm pretty sure the painting that you see is not, this is the copy. If you look really carefully, you can see it's not quite the same. So here, this is an article about this painting coming back that they used the copy. So there's this, you know, do they not know? Do they not care? Do they just couldn't get a good photo? I don't know, but I think that might be another. I hadn't thought about that. Thank you. I think I should let you all go to dinner.